Welcome back, Gadgeteers. I know it's been almost a week. I do apologize for that. I'll have another video out in a little while talking about what's going on behind FastGadgets, but for right now, I want to have a conversation with you and see what you think about a question that I saw quite a few times after I released my video talking about Linus Torvalds and the new code of conduct that's hit Linux and the effect that it's had on it. Whether or not we're looking at a culture war inside Linux and what the results will be. Now, the number one question that I saw in the comments was, why don't we as Linux developers take our code and move over to BSD? I wish it was that simple. The problem with a culture war of this type and having two sides sparring the way they are, you can count on the fact that if it's going on in one developer community or one community in general, not just software development, it's probably going on the other side of the fence. You've heard the saying, the grass is always greener on the other side of the fence, and that's pretty much exactly the case. As a matter of fact, one of the big problems with the BSDs right now is that in some ways to be quite honest, they're crumbling. I reported about a year ago, maybe 8 months ago, I'll put the link to the video up here, about FreeBSD having internal problems and financing problems and beginning to collapse inward on itself. Security updates not being done as often as they should. They took a long time to respond to Spectre and other vulnerabilities, mainly because they just don't have as many people working on it as they used to. Now, I have had some BSD contributors say, you know, that's not true. It's always been this way, meaning that maybe the turnaround isn't as fast, but the quality is good and the code is good. But lately, at least with one of the BSDs that we're going to look at, FreeBSD, they're actually having an internal war, and it is political in nature and definitely involves many SJW types, and that's really unfortunate. And they have adopted a new code of conduct that's actually far worse than what we see in the Linux kernel developer code of conduct, which we've talked about also. Now, the first thing I want to talk about is an article that I did talk about a year ago, and it was about whether or not the BSDs were dying, and some security researchers think so. And the reason I brought it up is because much of the code, the base code, mind you, not all the stuff on top, but the base code was originally part of FreeBSD, but things have changed, of course, and there have been many modifications by the coding people at Apple for macOS. So will there be a problem with macOS in the future? No, that's a whole nother topic. Watch my video on that one. But the importance was what's going on with the BSDs. There's a couple of big ones, FreeBSD, OpenBSD, and NetBSD. Now, one of the largest consumers and users of FreeBSD is Netflix. But given what's going on, it does make you wonder if Netflix will look for a different operating system, possibly Ubuntu's back in, or maybe Microsoft's new Azure, which is based on Linux, their back end. It's hard to say what's going to happen, but for right now, Netflix still does use FreeBSD, and I'm sure they contribute code to it as well, possibly also funding, which we're going to get into. So let's look at this article. It was published by J.M. Porup in January of 2018. If you want to sum it all up, this first paragraph does a good job. The open source Berkeley software distribution BSD versions of Unix suffer from a lack of eyeballs on their code, and that hurts their security. Ilya Van Sprundel, director of penetration testing at IOActive, told an audience at 34C3 in Leipzig, Germany at the end of December. Struck by the small number of reported BSD kernel vulnerabilities compared to Linux, Van Sprundel sat down last summer and reviewed the BSD code in his spare time. How come there are only a handful of BSD security bugs advisories released every year? Is it because the BSDs are so much more secure, or is it that no one is looking? Van Sprundle found about 150 kernel bugs across the three BSDs. He called them low-hanging fruit, easy to identify. He reported the bugs, but 6 months later, at the time of his talk, they remained unpatched. By and large, most security flaws in the Linux kernel don't have a long lifetime. They get found pretty fast. On the BSD side, this isn't always true. I found a bunch of bugs that have been around a very long time. Looking at the different BSDs, they go on to say that OpenBSD is the clear winner for security, which is a good thing, and has the most knowledgeable developers when it comes to security. So why is that? Well, we've got a smaller code base with OpenBSD. There aren't necessarily all the features there that we want or that people want or users want, but because that code base is so small, it does allow, of course, for less bugs. It's really pretty much logical. If you think about running your Linux system, if you do a netstat an and look at all the ports open, and then you were to run a headless version of Linux without the GUI running, and do a netstat an again, which is of course a command. I know many people don't like to use the command line, but sometimes you have to. You will find that there are so few ports open and so few processes running in comparison to running that GUI. So the less code that's involved in any distribution, of course, it just makes sense that there's going to be yet less security fixes that'll need to be done because they're not running that particular piece of code. With OpenBSD, this was a deliberate decision to reduce the attack surface, including removing support for rare, uncommon, and older devices and architectures. So the hardware level support for OpenBSD isn't going to be the greatest, but if you want something that's very secure and stable, as long as you're using the correct hardware, OpenBSD would be a decent choice. Unfortunately, because OpenBSD is less popular according to the author and Sprundle, the bugs are still easy to find, so more people who are thinking about BSD don't look at OpenBSD necessarily. Even the founder of OpenBSD chimed in to say, yeah, we could make OpenBSD more secure if we had more eyes looking at the code. NetBSD is the clear loser in terms of code quality. According to Van Sprundle's bug reports that were submitted, good news is they did fix all the bugs, nearly all the bugs that were submitted by Van Sprundle. The bad news is the patches have not been shipped to users yet. So kind of a problem there. We don't have secure code. You do have to keep in mind, though, that NetBSD is volunteer driven. It's fully open source and there's no full-time developers. Then we have the one we're going to talk most about, FreeBSD, the most technically advanced of the BSDs. Long heralded for the performance of its network stack, FreeBSD is by far the most popular of the three big BSDs and finds a home at Netflix and What's Up, among others. So FreeBSD did a pretty good job of responding on the kernel bugs Van Sprundle identified, but unfortunately they haven't been released yet, most of them, into the source tree. So we're not seeing those fixes. Now this was a year ago, so I'm sure they've been fixed by now, but things are a little slow. So according to Ed Mast, or Mast, Director of Project Development at the FreeBSD Foundation, there's some exploits, some vulnerabilities, I should say, that have no practical exploit. And he goes on to say, we've started treating some of these as just bugs and not as security issues. Now, in Linux, those vulnerabilities would most likely be patched. The reason being, again, they have more people, more coders to work on probable vulnerabilities that probably should be patched. Now, here they're talking about whether or not the FreeBSD network stack is superior. Now, some say that 10 years ago, absolutely it was, that more superior than Linux, but today they're saying, no, you know, Linux is easily a match for the FreeBSD network stack. Of the BSDs, which one is more likely to survive? Well, according to this author, OpenBSD may be the most likely to survive despite being far less popular than FreeBSD at the moment. I see a greater chance for OpenBSD to survive because it has a more focused use case and target specific things. FreeBSD, I think it's much more difficult for it to survive than OpenBSD. And again, that's one person's opinion. It could go either way. How could we track if FreeBSD was going to survive? Well, we could look at the financing, which we're going to do in just a minute. But before we do that, let's talk about what happened recently in February of 2018 when FreeBSD decided to change its code of conduct. So there was an article, and there are many different articles about this that you can find. This one I picked up from the Register, and it says, careful with the virtual hugs, says new FreeBSD code of conduct. Cue virtual outrage and actual culture war skirmishes. The FreeBSD project completely updated its code of conduct in early February, despite some people, well, many developers not liking the new code of conduct and considering it inflammatory and, in all actuality, biased. But one of the things that was in there, physical contact and simulated physical contact, textual descriptions like hug or back rub without consent or after a request to stop, will cause problems for you if you use it. FreeBSD Core team member Benno Rice told the Reg, the new code available was adopted because feedback suggested the old one could be improved. While it wasn't the best, it certainly wasn't the worst. Now, this is the person who was very angry when Randy Harper was asked to stand down, so-called FreeBSD girl, from the FreeBSD development, because she was a real problem. She was a quintessential and still is SJW. I don't know too much about her, but I do know some of the things that she did. And I did go look at some of the stuff that she said to other core members in the FreeBSD official IRC chat. It was nasty. Go F yourself, you know, die, cis white male, that kind of stuff that really doesn't enfranchise one to open an honest discussion of a topic. When you start out with that kind of stuff, it definitely is going to detract from an honest discussion. I'm not here to judge her, though, because I don't know the full story, and it's very possible somebody did the same to her. So I'm not going to say whether or not she was right or wrong, but anyway, I guess that many were relieved to see her go, but that's a whole nother story. However, I have a definite suspicion that that is part of what caused the core team to have a look at a new code of conduct, because it might have been much more difficult to get her out. Although, after I saw what I saw in the IRC chat logs, I would say that it was more than sufficient to get her banned from FreeBSD development community altogether. FreeBSD's Rice told us the intent of virtual hugs clause is to make sure it's okay before you do it. The point, he said, is that FreeBSD is acknowledging that harassment is subjective. What's acceptable between friends or with permission may or may not be acceptable from a stranger, or if it's repeated after someone asks that it stop. I have to agree with that. That makes sense to me. And it is reasonable for somebody to not like something that on the surface is too familiar too soon when you don't really know that person. Rice agreed that there was criticism of the code within the project, but said the most egregious stuff has come from the outside. That doesn't appear to be the case. We're going to look at an email from a BSD, FreeBSD contributor who also posted links to internal emails, about 200, that were very interesting when they were talking about adopting the new code of conduct. The problem was, of course, they had already adopted the new code of conduct, this core team. By doing that, it made the discussion futile because they really couldn't do anything to change it. It was there and it was going to stay. So you can't really have a discussion about something once it's already been implemented. I mean, you can, but if part of the purpose of the discussion is to alter it prior to its adoption, well, that would fail, of course, because a certain core group decided this is the way it's going to be, and then it did. So here's an interesting quote from Benno Rice. He says, "Some people didn't like it," referring to the new code of conduct, "because it's based on an example of an anti-harassment policy at the Geek Feminism Wiki." Okay, well, I really don't have any objection to somebody who's feminist or feminist groups in general, but what if we said our code of conduct was coming from a white, cis, male, gendered, binary wiki? How would that sit with the others? Well, just any developers in general. I'm guessing some would say it was fine and some would not like it. Well, I think that by doing that, we've basically adopted something that is not in the center or neutral or unbiased. It's automatically biased. That's how I see it. I don't know. Maybe you see it differently. But Rice said, "Criticism of the code from within the FreeBSD community often asks why it used the Geek Feminism Wiki as its base, while other discussions and thread could be filed under either, oh God, not another code of conduct, or did we really have to do this?" That is the question. I couldn't find anything about any abuse in the FreeBSD core team or in the system in general. There were quite a few years with Randy Harper that were problematic. That seemed to have sorted itself out before the new code of conduct arrived. So let's take a look at this new code of conduct. Now, one of the things I want to point out in one of the emails that I was reading in the discussion about this code of conduct, one of the FreeBSD internal emails that were not supposed to be seen by the public, which we are able to read because there were some people that posted those. And I think that's fair, because if you're a developer but you're not in the core team, why is it you can't see these emails and be a part of this discussion? Doesn't make sense to me. But part of the problem they were saying with the FreeBSD code of conduct was essentially that it was a list of what not to do instead of a list of behaviors and ethical and moral positions that one should ascribe to if you're going to be a part of FreeBSD, the project. So instead, we're just going to list things you shouldn't or can't do. And some of them are so obscure. For me, coming from the Midwest, and I pray and thank God every day that the Midwest has not been completely yet overrun by this plague of leftist, idealist, extremist liberals out there. And I know that it can be just as bad on the other side. I kind of sit in the middle. I still see that, at least politically, in where I'm from in the Midwest. And keep in mind, I work for very liberal organizations. We haven't seen this slow disintegration of the extreme left and extreme right constantly at war. And you get to the point where you basically say anything wrong to the wrong person. I'm sorry I misgendered you. I didn't know that I was supposed to call you they instead of he or she. You know, none of that has come up yet. So let's have a look at this FreeBSD code of conduct. Now, in the first part is pretty typical. FreeBSD project is inclusive. We want the FreeBSD project to be a venue where people of all backgrounds can work together to make the best operating system, la la la. Diversity is a huge strength. I don't deny that that is the case. I never have and never will. I've worked and have been proud to work with and teach students of all races, creeds, colors, cultures, backgrounds, and I consider myself really fortunate, because it gives you a different viewpoint. You don't want to have what I used to call yes men all around you, but now we can just call them yes people. You know, that basically you say, hey, I think we should do this with our project, and they all say, yes, very good idea, when in reality they know it's a really bad idea. They're just not going to say so because they have to agree with you. That's bad. Diversity is a good thing. The problem here, and we'll go on, is down here. This document is not an exhaustive list of all things that you should not do. I feel like we're being punished already if you think about it. It's very disciplinarian. It's not telling you what they want. It's telling you what they don't want. Consider it a guide to make it easier to enrich all of us. How do we enrich us if we only know what we're not supposed to do? Let's look at some of the bullets down here that they consider harassment. Comments that are that reinforce systemic oppression related to gender, gender identity and expression, sexual orientation, disability, mental illness, neurodiversity, physical appearance, body size. I think that's reasonable. You know, everybody should know that, but it's really funny. Every time we do sexual harassment training, I'm stunned at those who really didn't know it was an issue. And even after training, we've still had issues come up. Part of it is ignorance. Part of it is just a refusal to join everybody in the 21st century. And you don't have to be an SJW to appreciate that this part here is reasonable. Unwelcome comments. Yeah, I think so. Deliberate. Now, I'm glad they used the word deliberate. Deliberate misgendering. So at least you get that first time. If you misgender somebody and they correct you, thereafter you are being harassing. Deliberate use. This was the one I think is really obscure. Deliberate use of dead or rejected names. I think somebody's going to have to comment down below and explain this one to me. I kind of think I get it. Gratuitous or off-topic sexual images or behavior in spaces where they are not appropriate. Yeah, I mean, I think that's reasonable. Physical contact and simulated physical contact. What do you do if you accidentally bump somebody? I mean, I would be terrified to work in this environment. I hate that it has to be said, but then again, I've seen the other side of the coin too, so. Anyway, threats of violence, fair. Incitement of violence towards any individual, fair. Deliberate intimidation, stalking, or following, yeah, I think that's fair. These ones, you know, kind of take us into, you know, modern technology. Unwelcome sexual attention, not that one. Patterns of inappropriate social contact, such as requesting, assuming inappropriate levels of intimacy with others. Continued one-on-one communication after request to cease. Deliberate outing of any private aspect of a person's identity without their consent, except as necessary to protect vulnerable people from intentional use. Publication of non-harassing private communication without consent. Publication of non-harassing private communication with consent, but in a way that intentionally misrepresents the communication. An example, removes context that changes the meaning, knowingly making harmful false claims about a person. Most of these I can agree with, and it's sad that you have to tell people about them, but some of them are really weird to me. They're just odd. The misgender thing, I think it's fair that if somebody wants to be labeled a certain gender, this is my opinion. I know those that really are on the right side are going to disagree with me, and that's fine. You can disagree all you want. If somebody wants to be called a certain gender, I don't have a problem with that. I will confess, because of my upbringing and everything that I've been through and all my experiences in life, I've known only two. So for me to make a mistake more than once quite frequently is very likely. Very likely indeed. It's, you know, something that would take a long time for many people to change. And I personally think that the word deliberate in here is very smart, because many of us are not going to be able to change on a dime, and some of us may never be able to change. Think about the people you know in your life. And again, I hope we don't get offended about talking about age, but some people in your life that are older that you know use dead terms, deliberate use of dead or rejected names, like it's fine, and you say, hey, you can't say that anymore, and they still do it anyway, and then they go and do it out in public and they don't see a problem with it. And they're not that they're not willing to change per se, but they just can't imagine a world where it's an issue. I've seen that quite a lot. Another issue that they were talking about with this particular policy is the fact that any incidents that violates this code of conduct will be pursued and investigated even if it results in no action. And by a mere vote of the core team, I believe, they could take you out and you will no longer be a part of FreeBSD. They talk about that. What happens after you file a report? The committee will meet as quickly as possible to review the incident and determine whether an investigation is needed, what appears to have happened, and whether the behavior constitutes a code of conduct violation. Actions taken may include nothing. If determined to be a solely technical in nature, or if it falls outside the scope of code of conduct, forward the incident to the core team, private reprimand, a public reprimand, an imposed vacation from FreeBSD, a permanent or temporary ban, a request for a public or private apology, a request to engage in mediation and or accountability plan. Only permanent resolutions, such as bans, may be appealed. So think about that. This probably is the worst part, in my opinion. So if you are innocent and the investigation proves, it doesn't prove otherwise, but it says otherwise, and you get a permanent mark on your record, but it's temporary, maybe you get a public reprimand, there is no appeal. Interesting. Hey, look at this. Glossary, dead names. A name assigned to a person at birth, which they no longer identify with, most often used to refer to the assigned name of a trans person who has publicly identified themselves under a new name. Deliberately using a dead name is an act of hostility. It specifically refers to trans individuals. So I've learned something new. Anyways, the attribution, the code of conduct is based on the example policy from the Geek Feminism Wiki. What's going on? What's happening since then? Now, if we look about 6 to 10 months later, there was an interesting email by John Dara, presumably not 6 to 10 months later, my apology, about a month after the adoption of the COC. John Dara, who is presumably a part of FreeBSD, sent different links that you can download and look at all of the emails, and I'll make sure this link is in the description of this video, where you can look at the 200 or so emails where they discussed the adoption of this code of conduct. And this is a very interesting email. I'm going to read a little bit of it. John Dara says, FreeBSD recently introduced an updated code of conduct that developers and members must adhere to. There's been much backlash online about it and about introducing identity politics into a technical OS project in general. The code of conduct was adopted from the Geek Feminism. We know that. Emails of the internal discussion about this controversial code of conduct have now been leaked publicly, painting a picture of the disagreement in the FreeBSD project about how this was handled. A number of developers, and these are at least one, Benno is in the core team here, Benno, PHK, and Dez, have used racist and sexist remarks against those criticizing the far-reaching project policy change, saying that the concerns about the policy essentially boil down to white male privilege and being on the wrong side of history. That I would have a big problem with. Other developers, you see, the thing about, I gotta go back. This assumes that you believe in the concept of white male privilege. This is definitely a touchy subject with those in information technology. I always look at the concept of white male privilege and I think about the tiny modest home that I have here and my modest income and this 20-year-old car that I'm driving, and I think, why isn't my white male privilege working for me? How come I'm not filthy rich and doing so well? Why? What's going on here? And the thing is, has there been a time where there was white male privilege? I think we, again, this is my opinion. Many people will disagree with me and get angry because I'm saying this. But yeah, I think there was at one point quite a bit of white male. I don't know about privilege, but boy, they were definitely on the top of the pecking order, especially if you think about it in the 40s, 50s, and 60s. Things have changed quite a lot now. There's more equality than there's ever been, meaning specifically everybody has an opportunity to achieve their dreams. Yes, some roads are harder than others for a variety of reasons, but it has less to do with race and culture and background than it ever has before. I say this confidently because I know many, many people who I have taught, again, that were many races, many different backgrounds, cultures, religions, that in each group, there are those that excelled and became successful and those that didn't. And what I saw when I was teaching my classes is that the ones that became successful were the ones that put in the work, while the ones that didn't did not put in the work, would literally not show up for class. And it didn't have anything to do with the racial background or anything like that. So I think that opportunity is there. And like I said, every individual is in a different situation, so they can't necessarily all have an equal footing from which to start on their journey to achieve whatever greatness they envision for themselves. And certainly what life circumstances you're born into will definitely add to the difficulty of what you want to achieve. In my case, I was born into a family with an alcoholic father who was around, but not very much. Actually, he was around too much in the beginning because he drank a lot and he was abusive. And then my mother and father got divorced. He died when I was very, very young. I learned more about being a young man from my brother than anybody else, my older brother, Richie. And my mother was on welfare. We didn't have any income. My father died without leaving us any money. We almost lost the house. We had old used cars all my life. We didn't get all the cool stuff for Christmas. That was the way it was. And I didn't have any money for college. I had to borrow money for college. I had to work extra jobs. I worked third shift for a very long time. I was raising children and going to school full time all at once. I don't remember any white privilege or anybody handing me something on a silver platter saying, you know what, you're a white male. We're just going to give you this cash. You can do what you want with it, pay for your degree, your family, et cetera, et cetera. I was given some things, but only because I worked really hard for it. I really did. And my circumstances were not great, but I managed to eke a reasonable living, and what I have today is what I want to have. I'm happy with what I have today. I actually prefer teaching than I would being on the top in IT like I was at one point and getting paid top dollar because of the pressure. And, you know, pressure is fine, whatever, but with my heart, which many of you viewers know about, I really couldn't do that, so I had to make some hard life choices, and I decided to stick with teaching, and I tried to keep pushing on my PhD, but with my health the way it is now, unfortunately, I couldn't do that. So I know this is a huge segue, but the point being, this concept of white male privilege, at least for me individually, now, sorry, nobody gives me anything for free. Nobody. and no entity, no organization. And I don't know about you guys, but I wish that were the case. Honestly, I don't, because I want to work for the things that I get. It definitely gives me warm and fuzzy, happy, good feelings inside to know that I made that happen. You know, when I went out and bought this last house with my wife, I was proud of the fact that we worked for it. We worked very hard. We saved a little extra money, and we were able to buy a house, this being my third house, and I was really happy that we could do that. And it was a hard road. It took months to do it, but we did it. Anyway, back to this email. So, other developers expressed concern about the policy being thrown upon them with no discussion or debate, as well as the FreeBSD Foundation's choice to pay an outside person with donations from the users to work on the Code of Conduct's enforcement. Said person identifies as a feminist. The last line, okay, well, what if they do? But anyway, the other stuff, paying people, hopefully it's within budgetary constraints. I don't think it was, and we're going to see what the effect was in just a minute. Mods on BSD and FreeBSD-related subreddits are censoring posts, removing threads, banning users from posting the link. Colin Percival is among the mods doing the removal. FreeBSD forum mods are also cracking down and eliminating any discussion. Censorship is not the way to win culture wars. So if you want to read these emails, I mean, it's a lot of reading, and the format they're in makes it even more difficult to read, but possibly if you do the download, it might be a little bit easier to read. Anyway, I'll have that link for you. So what's happened to FreeBSD since? This is a thread by SJW FreeBSD, and it's titled "Additional Thoughts on FreeBSD's Death Spiral." With the devastating news that FreeBSD donations have dropped roughly in half, let's look down here. Compared to 2017, which already failed to meet their target for 2017, take a look at this, at some informal data about the project's online presence. The lack of any interest and activity in social media about FreeBSD is shocking. This is a project that almost no one has any interest in. I cannot corroborate that. The number of tweets about FreeBSD each day is tiny. And almost all of these tweets get little or no response. A couple years ago, there was a huge amount of interest from the Linux community looking to escape the systemd fiasco to FreeBSD. That interest has completely disappeared. The Linux community is making progress with routing around the systemd cancer, and the distros that aren't infected with the technological turd that is systemd are rapidly growing. The two biggest reasons Linux users and developers were looking to escape the systemd fiasco was ZFS and DTrace. They are now available in Linux. It should be obvious why the tiny group of toxic SJWs who hijacked FreeBSD were so desperate to silence and ban anyone who warned about the lunatic SJW Code of Conduct fiasco, destroying the project's financial and developer support. Anyway, he goes on, or she, or they, we really can't be sure, discussing the whole situation with FreeBSD, but there were some other posts, one on Reddit here, where Bearded GNU Freak said, "I just looked up the financials of the FreeBSD Foundation. In 2017, they had a fundraising goal of $1.25 million. They didn't meet that goal. They hit a little bit below at $1.1 million. Still, in the first quarter of 2017, they managed to get $425,000 in contributions. Compare this to the first quarter of 2018, only $189,000 in contributions. We're 7 months into 2018. According to the counter on their website, they currently have received about $303,000 in contributions. That's less than they managed to secure in the first 3 months of 2017. Now, in 2016, they managed to get $1.54 million. Well above their $1.25 million target. So you can see year after year, FreeBSD is making less and less money. Now, does that mean it is the Code of Conduct? I don't think so. not specifically the code of conduct itself, but I think it's reasonable to say that as somebody who's a private contributor, donator to FreeBSD, if you caught wind of any of these internal politics and what was going on, it definitely would leave a sour taste in your mouth, and you would probably be more likely to move your money somewhere else into another project that you think was more feasible. Some of these groups are going to be individuals. Some are going to be, I won't say investors, but contributors that, like a business or an organization like Netflix, that sees FreeBSD as something they need to cultivate and continue to see grow. But with all the warring that's going on inside FreeBSD, at least politically, it makes you nervous. It makes these organizations nervous. So I can see where they would be backing off and saying, no, you know what? I think we're going to hold off and we're going to move our money to another project, or maybe do it in-house. It really is hard to say. Now, on 8.2, Bearded Gnu Freak again said, it's getting ugly in FreeBSD forums and mailing lists. You have FreeBSD developers who are livid that everything they warned about in this toxic code of conduct being rammed down everyone's throats is coming true, with donations collapsing. Interesting thing is that there seems to be more corporate support, just in kind. Intel developers working on BSD, for example. So contributing source code is a lot different than dollars. So is it the end for FreeBSD? I don't think, not yet. Maybe not for a long time. Maybe not at all. It might just die that slow, ugly death. Or those of you that are actually working on FreeBSD or contribute, you know, I'd like to hear your inside viewpoint. It's something I don't see. So I feel like, you know, with organizations like these, they don't just die very quickly. So it wouldn't surprise me at all to see FreeBSD around in some form for quite a while longer. I can't honestly say that it will die ever. I really don't know. But I think it's fair to say that the code of conduct probably had some influence on what was happening internally and what was happening with the finances. But we really don't know how much, because we don't know who the contributors are, the donors of this money, and why they're no longer donating. There could be other outside reasons why the money's drying up. But it looks like, at the very least, there's some hard times coming up for FreeBSD. And we're going to see what happens in the future. But as you can see, the BSDs are not going to come to the rescue of the Linux kernel or Linux in general. I mean, it just isn't viable. We can't run to the BSDs like everybody wants. And there's many saying that, you know, doing a fork of the kernel isn't tenable either. I feel like the best solution of all of this, for those of you who've gotten to the end of this video, is for everybody to learn to get along, because many times with war, even the winners end up losing everything. So it is possible that we have these sides that are sparring and fighting so much that it poisons the well, so to speak, and the whole community dies and there's nothing left for anybody, and everybody blames the other group. I think it's very important that we learn to get along, just like we did when we were kids. You know, that's the one thing our parents told us: you better be able to get along, because that's the most important thing. In our country now, with politics being so divisive and things just going completely haywire, and we're getting to the point where the left and the right are the extremes. I'm not talking about those that are still ethical and lawful, but the extremes are really, and we're seeing it on TV, so people think that's the way it is, so you have to fight hard every time for everything instead of compromising and not screaming in each other's ears. Looking at these projects and what's going on, even if you come out as the winner of the war, you may lose everything anyway, so consider that. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, like and subscribe. If you really like this video, consider, of course, sharing. I always appreciate that. And as always, thank you for watching. I'll see you again soon on FastGadgets.
This video was made possible with support from viewers like you.
If you find this video useful, consider becoming a patron for as little as a dollar a month at patreon.com/fastgadgets.